Let us now visit Professor Kirchhoff. Okay, we know Kirchhoff only through Wheatstone bridge, sorry, not Wheatstone bridge, where we apply in electrical circuits. Okay, but the same Kirchhoff has given us a law for emissivity equal to absorptivity. Already we have stated that, but then this is little involved explanation. Let us go through this line by line, because this is a proof which is based on explanations, what heuristics, that is based on pure logic. There is no derivation as such, but interestingly he had first stated without derivation, later on he came up with heuristics. So it is not a derivation per se, but it is heuristic based off basis of arguing things out and saying that okay, it is convincing. Okay, but in true sense it is not derivation. Okay, so Kirchhoff's law, what does it say? Let us take a large isothermal enclosure, that is which is maintained at a temperature Ts. Consider a large isothermal enclosure of surface temperature Ts within which several small bodies are confined. Okay, but these bodies are so small that one is not going to interfere with the other. Okay, now this surface, at least this cavity, is going to, this can be visualized as a, what can I visualize? Okay, let us go line by line. Since these bodies are small relative to the enclosure, they have negligible influence on the radiation field, which is due to the cumulative effect of the emission and reflection by the enclosure surface. Because enough emission and reflection is happening, so one is not getting affected by the other. Regardless of the radiative properties, such a surface forms a black body cavity. Is that okay? Fine. Accordingly, regardless of its orientation, what is the irradiation? What is the irradiation experienced by any body overall? Because it is going to get irradiated not only from the cavity that is Ts, but also other bodies. So now, what will be the irradiation? That is the, because now we have said that every body is a black body. So irradiation will also be equal to Eb at a temperature Ts. Now, under steady state conditions, under steady state means all bodies are now going to reach in thermal equilibrium with reference to my enclosure temperature. So all bodies are going to sit at one temperature, that is Ts. So that is what is being told in the first two. So if I do energy balance, what do I get? That is what in fact professor had already told. This is E dot in minus E dot out equal to 0, that is all. What is this? What is the first term saying? The absorptivity of my surface into irradiation into A1 minus of this is a black body, that is it is emitting E1 Ts A1 equal to 0. So what do I get? And of course, for a black body, irradiation is also equal to emissive power. Is that right? Can you see that? Yes. So if I now equate this, what do I get? Alpha 1 equal to E1 Ts upon Eb Ts. This is what we have derived. So what does this say? I am halfway through. This is only saying that it is again the same as what we had said, no real surface can emit more than the black body. But that is not, the story is not over. Now if I take total hemispherical emissivity is also defined as, we have already defined this as EFT upon emissive power of real surface upon emissive power of black surface. So if I equate that, this equation with this equation, I am going to get emissivity equal to absorptivity. This is not a pure derivation, but this is, as I said, logically we are arguing out and saying that emissivity is equal to absorptivity. But the restrictive condition is that this should be at the, see, in this derivation itself we have said that my body is at, they are all in thermal equilibrium. So that means the temperatures are all same. So this is valid only when temperatures are same, that is emissivity is equal to absorptivity at the same temperature. So this is one thing, and of course there are various things one can they say that one can argue out and say that spectral emissivity is also equal to spectral absorptivity, and again spectral directional emissivity is also equal to spectral directional absorptivity. So this was done by Kirchhoff. Again, as usual, my usual tendency is to put the photograph and put something about him. So Kirchhoff, in fact, he has circuits laws were done as a part of his seminar exercise. Okay, so and later on he worked on the same thing for his dissertation, but of course he did this in 1859, and the spectroscopic work whatever I was talking about, that was all done along with Kirchhoff, along with Bunsen. Kirchhoff and Bunsen have worked together and found, because with spectroscopy only you can identify, as professor was saying, you can identify the elements. That's what precisely they did and found out cesium and rubidium. Okay, so okay, I think we will spend time on only one another thing which is very important, that is before we move on to gray surface, two things I will, I know you are all hungry, our energy levels are going down, but I think this is a reasonably well understood thing. What is greenhouse effect? I am sure most of you are explaining this in the class, so I would like to listen from you rather than me telling you, with the help of this figure. What is greenhouse effect? I always tell this in a car, if we park a car in a broad daylight, and when we get into that, we always feel very hot, unusually hot. Okay, so why is it so?
It does not allow the infrared radiation to come out from the body.
Yeah, you should be explaining with reference to transmissivity. I am showing transmissivity with reference to wavelength. Of course, for different thicknesses, that does not matter.
High frequency solar radiation can enter that house, but after reflection or whatever emitted radiations are there, they are low frequency and they cannot cross that cover, and so they are trapped.
Yeah, how do you decide whether that is high frequency or low frequency?
Because it is emitted from high temperature source.
That's true. So the solar radiation, that is the solar temperature, is sitting at 5800 Kelvin. So for the first timers only I am explaining this, for the other guys please feel bored, please pardon me for that. See, you have for the low frequencies, that is between 0.3 to 3 micrometer, 0.3 to 3 micrometer, what is the transmissivity? It's maximum. So here you have maximum transmissivity, but within the car the temperature is quite low, it's almost near about room temperature. Though that is high frequency, the transmissivity there is almost zero. So whatever comes in cannot get out from by radiation. That's why people keep their car windows slightly open, so that convection, some air blows inside and some convection happens and it's little cooler. Okay, I think this we should spend a lot of time in the class. Why? Because this is another instance where wavelength and temperature, for a given temperature, what is the wavelength? You will have to go back. I am not going back here because you are all conversant. You have to go back to Planck's distribution. You have to, in fact, we can put Planck's distribution again here. We can again copy paste that Planck's distribution here and say that, okay, otherwise how will you know 5800 is 0.3 to 3 micrometer? It has to come from Planck's distribution. So we have to show the student the Planck's distribution and make him appreciate that for a given temperature, I am in this domain at 5800, and for room temperature I am somewhere here. So that's what I need to show. So this is what we need to emphasize for the students. Okay, next thing is the gray surface. What is a gray surface? Someone was asking me over coffee. So gray surface is that surface which is dependent on this tells, this is the summary of everything. This is the summary of everything. Okay, real surface is going to be dependent on direction and wavelength. Diffuse surface is one which is independent of direction. Let's not get confused. Diffuse, the very fact, diffuse, the word diffuse means it's independent of direction. Okay, So you use the word, actually my head is a little diffused today, you use that word actually. Means you don't know what you are doing, you are directionless, you are rudderless, that's what you mean actually. I mean, why I use these examples, because when you relate with English, it becomes that much easier to understand that. That's why I said in the very first lecture, you use technical terms in your colloquial language, then those terms become very obvious to you, okay. So epsilon lambda, what does this here? If a surface is dependent only on wavelength, then it is gray surface. If it is diffuse and gray, if it is diffuse and gray, sorry, what did I say? That's right. No, did I make a mistake when I told gray surface? What is a gray surface? What is a gray surface? Just to check out whether I have told the right thing or not. Yeah, gray surface is that surface in which it is independent of wavelength. Now it becomes diffuse and gray means and direction. Okay, okay. I think these are things which we should be very clear about. Okay. I think with this I will skip this commentary because it is little complicated. I don't think we should be touching upon that, but I think we will. Okay. So before we closed for lunch, I think we had spent the whole morning trying to understand some fundamentals, definitions related to radiation. Now, having done that, I think this part is relatively easy compared to what was done in the morning. So we are going to talk about interaction between two surfaces. So all this while fundamentals of radiation definitions, we were dealing with one surface. We were not concerned with its interaction with surrounding surfaces or surrounding objects, and we were dealing with a particular surface, whether it is with respect to emission, irradiation, absorption, transmission, reflection, all those things was related to one particular surface, and we did not care about what was the source of energy or source of radiation that was incident on that surface. We did not bother about it, but in real life that is not possible. So always we are going to have interacting surfaces, and I think these things students will understand very easily. You can say, if I examples are given here, facing the fire from front or back, you have different kind of radiation than from the side. If I stand directly under the light, I feel little bit hotter than if I stand like this. So all these examples students will appreciate very easily. We don't have to spend too much time on that. So we quantify, or we are now, we have to give a mathematical form or some kind of a number to this concept of farthness, nearness, relative position with respect to the parent surface, and so on and so forth. So mathematically we put together some kind of a formulation and we call it as a view factor, configuration factor or view factor. I think everybody likes this, will appreciate this, it is quite easy, and always we like to give a problem also related to view factor calculation. Why, what is it physically telling us? It is telling us what is the fraction of energy which is leaving a particular surface which is being intercepted by the receiving surface. That is all it is. It is a fraction. So it has to be between 0 and 1. And mathematically we are going to derive a simple equation for it. All textbooks will have this, all of us will do this also. And there are some general rules which will be there. View factor with respect to itself need not always be equal to 0, it depends on the geometry of the surface. So the points to take home would be the geometry of the surface, the orientation, the relative distances, all these three are going to contribute. The size of the surface, geometry of the surface, the orientation, the same two plates, okay. If I think of these two, these are two plates. If they are one above the other, the view factor is different. If I move them farther away, it is going to be different. If I move them like this, like this, like this, each time you get a different number for view factor. It is primarily because as I move away, the amount of radiation which surface 2 receives from surface 1 will change because of the nearness or farness or the orientation. I think that is quite straightforward. So, Fij represents the fraction of radiation leaving surface I that strikes surface j. 1 to 2 means leaving surface 1 striking surface 2, 2 to 1 is the other way. And if this is dA1, we always like to deal with infinitesimal areas. So, this is dA1 and you think of the outward normal n1, dA2 and this is the outward normal n2. The angle made by the ray joining the center to this center makes an angle theta 1 with the normal here and makes an angle theta 2 with the normal here. And this area dA2 which is receiving from 1 subtends the solid angle d omega to 1. Okay, these are all conventions to 1, okay, of 2 with respect to 1, that is what it means. And the center to center distance is given by r. So, with this diagram we can say solid angle d omega to 1 is nothing but dA2 cos theta 2 divided by r2 square. So, this is again a definition of solid angle we have. And then we say the portion or the fraction of energy which is going to be received q dA1 to dA2 is nothing but what is I intensity. So, we always have to keep that in mind. So, what is the dimension of this quantity I units? Watt per meter square. So, I cos theta 1 dA1 d omega 2 to 1. So, where did I get this from? Where did I get this equation from? Have you seen this equation before? Definition. Definition of intensity is nothing but dq divided by dA cos theta, d omega, d lambda, etcetera, etcetera. The same thing now I have cast it in dq is equal to dI times all these things. So, nothing new so far. And how do I know it is from 1 to 2 and not 2 to 1?
By omega
2 1. Omega 2 1. Not omega 1 to 2. Okay. So, dA1 cos theta 1. Two things are there to tell you what we are, what is the sending surface and what is the receiving surface. And here we are dealing with the sending surface by suffix 1, receiving surface by suffix 2, subscript 2. So, dA1 cos theta 1, what is this cos theta 1 coming from? Where is this coming from? Why is this cos theta? Normal of the
force.
Okay.
Correct. Basically, this has to become
like that. So it has to be rotated by angle theta to so that the ray is perpendicular to that surface. Okay. So now is algebra. After we have understood this, it is just algebra. I will substitute for solid angle definition. So it will be dA2 cos theta 2 divided by R square, and total rate of radiation.
Actually, this is written little lengthy wise today morning. Okay, I realized. Let us write this equation. We can integrate it in one shot. Two transparencies can be skipped. Let us write this equation. That is Q dot dA1.
Let me write here.
Yeah, let's write this because in one Q dot
dA1 dA2 that is energy leaving dA1 reaching dA2 I1 cos theta 1 dA1 d omega T1 is dA2 cos theta 2 R square by R square. So, if I have to make it Q dot dA1 to A2, what should I do? Double integral. So, that is double integral A1 A2 I1 cos theta 1 cos theta 2 upon R square dA1 dA2. What is the energy leaving Q dot A1? What is the energy leaving Q dot A1? No, not just that, something is getting reflected also.
it is emitting and it is receiving something from some other sources, out of which some amount is getting reflected. So I have to take not the emissivity, emissive power alone, I have to take the radiosity. So that is J1 dA1, which is equal to, if it is a diffuse, no, I don't have to make any
no assumption.
So J1 is equal to
EB1 plus rho 1 G1. How do I remember this?
I don't have to do any special effort. J is equal to the sum of emission plus reflected component of all incident radiation.
Always I draw this for myself. So that is G is coming, emission is E, and some amount is getting reflected. How much is getting reflected?
Rho times G.
So G equal to,
so J is equal to E plus rho. So if that is the case, that's what is given here. In fact, from that I will get, so this will be E plus rho G times dA1. Okay. So what are we looking at? We are looking at a ratio, fraction. Okay. So what it will be? Q A1 to A2 divided by QA1. Correct? Divided by QA1. So if I just go back one slide. So if you are talking of the total quantity, total rate of radiation in all direction, that is what we have to make this assumption of diffuse, it is going to be J times A1, which is nothing but pi times I1 A1. This pi I is equal to J comes from the fact that it is a diffuse surface for emission plus
reflection.
Okay, back again. What is diffuse surface? Something which has no directional preference for anything. Okay. So it can be diffuse for emission, but it need not be diffuse for reflection. What we are saying is this surface 1 is diffuse both for emission as well as for reflection. That means it has no directional preference for both these things. So radiosity also is a diffuse, it is a diffuse emitter and a diffuse reflector. So I can write J is equal to pi times I. I is what? Intensity. Okay, it is, and pi is introduced because of this integration around the full direction. Okay. So all I have said, this is a heat flux, J is a heat flux. I am replacing J by pi times I. I am carrying this pi because of this directional business. Okay. So this is heat flux times the area, which is watts. Is that clear? Parshuramji, VJTI, Nirma, everybody, okay. I think it is easier to remember colleges than names. Okay. Portion of this radiation which strikes dA2.
This is a, if I integrate it in all directions, diffuse. You go back, what was our definition? E is equal to
we are not doing black body.
E is equal to, if when I say it is diffuse, you remember in our first radiation 1, E equal to pi I E.
Here, that is what is open directly. Okay.
That is what it is. So this is nothing to do with black body.
E is equal to pi I.
Diffuse, if it is independent of
this
direction.
E is for emission. J is equal to pi I, where the subscript will be E plus R, meaning it is diffuse for both, instead of talking ever, it will be, if I want to write, it will be J is equal to pi times I of E plus R. That means this is for emission and this is for reflection, and this comes because of diffuse nature. It is diffuse for both these things. Okay. So fraction is what we are saying. Now this is Q of A1 to dA2. It was dA1 to dA2. Now we are saying A1 to dA2, so integrate over area 1, and double integral will make it integrated from for both the areas. So one large surface to another large surface. And if I go to the next thing, the fraction essentially will be obtained by bringing this down, that is it. So I will have F1 to 2 is nothing but 1 over A1 integral A1 to A2, this is just algebra, so there is nothing to teach conceptually here. Cos theta 1 cos theta 2 dA1 dA2 by pi r square. What it tells me is that it depends on size, relative sizes of the objects given by dA1 and dA2. It depends on the physical distance between the objects r square which is coming there. It depends on the cos theta 1 cos theta 2 or the relative orientation, okay. How is it oriented? That is why I told you the same parallel plates, I mean same set of rectangular plates, when it is moved this way, this way, this way, you have the different view factor because the orientation has changed, the cos theta will get changed. And of course, this very same equation will give us F21, and that, and if I multiply this here, F12 times A1 is equal to F21 times A2, because this integral essentially is the same. So that will give me what we call as the famous reciprocity rule, and I will just quickly go through the other rules also and then we will come back to this. Reciprocity relation, other is summation rule, which says energy is conserved. So summation of energies going from surface I to all other j surfaces 1, 2, 3, 4 up to n should add up to what is leaving. So that is energy balance, we cannot violate that. So if you divide through by energy that is leaving the surface, you get view factor of surface I with respect to 1 plus view factor of surface 2 with respect to 1 all the way till n with respect to 1, the sum has to be equal to 1. So again, that is what it says. So summation of view factors from surface I to of an enclosure to all other surfaces of the enclosure including itself must be equal to unity. I think students will be able to write all this, but you ask them what it is, that is where the problem comes. So example, three surfaces F11, 12, 13 summation equal to 1, one of these can be 0, F121 can be 0 depending on the orientation or the geometry, but in general the rule is all the view factors have to be taken into account. So, okay. I do not want to spend time, I think we will go back to other rules or splitting rule also, okay. Yeah. Superposition rule, suppose I have to deal with this to this view factor F1 to this long surface and it is split into 2 and 3, I can write this as F1 to 2 plus F1 to 3. Many times I will want to find out the view factor of F1 to 3 actually. So I will get F of this to this minus F of 1 to 2, okay, that is where this will be useful. Surface I to a surface j is equal to sum of the view factors of surface I to several parts associated with surface j. Reverse is not true, okay, that is not true, the converse is definitely not true. And that is a typical question which also university where they will ask. So I am not going to do this. So F1 2 to 3 is equal to 1 to 2 plus 1 to 3, whereas F 2 to 3 2 3 to 1 is not equal to F21 plus F31, okay. Okay, I will then quickly go through this standard stuff, okay. Plane surface 1 to 1 is 0. Plane surface view factor to itself is 0, convex surface view factor to itself is 0, concave surface view factor to itself is non-zero, okay. This is something which we have to keep in mind. Inner sphere, inner cylinder to outer sphere or outer cylinder view factor is 1, outer sphere to inner sphere, outer cylinder to inner sphere, cylinder view factor is not 1 because part of it is going to see itself. Now tell me, if I reduce the diameter of this inner cylinder, let us take this as cylinder, it is easy to visualize cylinder. if I reduce the diameter of the inner cylinder to a smaller and smaller value, what happens to F21? Decreases, remains same, increases? F21. It will tend to 0, because bulk of the energy is seen by the parent surface itself, very few, very small fraction will go to the other surface. Now, if I bring it closer and closer, when I make the gap between the two small, then what happens? 2 to 2 will almost become 0, 2 to 1 will almost become 0.9 point whatever. Okay, what is the inherent assumption in this whole thing? Let us, we are dealing with cylinder, right? So, let us deal with cylinder. I will draw two cylinders, coaxial ones. This is cylinder 1 and this is cylinder 2, okay, longer. What am I saying? F1, F1 to 2, etcetera. What is the meaning? What is the inherent assumption? Concentric is correct, we are not changing geometry. End effects are neglected, okay. What other major assumption? Okay, right. Or anything with respect to temperature? Entire object, entire body is at uniform temperature, okay. Why? How do you know that assumption? Which aspect of the derivation gives you that thing implied? Do not sleep. Which aspect of the derivation tells you, or is, where is it implied that the temperature is assumed to be constant? Which aspect of the derivation tells you about constant temperature? Source, sink, both. In here, it is somewhere implied. What, okay, conversely, what if it was varying temperature? What will happen? No, let us say, you know, we are going digressing too much, but why this constant temperature is important, I am saying. Let us say this is at T1, this is at T3, this is at T2 and this is a T4, hypothetically, okay. What will happen? Intensity, amount of energy emitted by this part will be different than what is emitted by this part. Whereas here, I have not even bothered about that. I have taken one I, intensity is constant, right. Was intensity treated as a function of geometry or R or L or anything? Nothing was that. I was a number, okay. I was always treated as one whole quantity. So, temperature being constant is an implicit thing. So can I not do anything with such problems? Of course, you can do. So, what you will do is, you have to be careful and treat each isothermal portion as one element. I'm reaching out to you. So, isothermally each portion is one element. Now, continuously if temperature is varying, what do you do? Piecewise linear, you can make piecewise constant, not piecewise linear, piecewise constant. So, why am I telling all this? Even if you impose constant wall heat flux condition or constant wall temperature condition or constant wall heat flux, many of the times you will not get a constant temperature depending on what is the environment, especially if heat is forced to be removed only by radiation and natural convection, the heat transfer coefficient is generally very, very poor, especially in the lower half, because it is only natural convection and you see a strong temperature gradient actually. So, what you will do is, you will deal with each thing as a ring, something like this. Each of this is at T2, T1, T3, T4, T5, so on and so forth, and correspondingly on the outer cylinder also you will have some kind of such rings with which this is going to talk, this is going to talk to this, this is going to talk to the next one, so on and so forth. Same thing for everything. So T3 is going to talk to the topmost ring, it is going to talk to the second last, third last, something in front of it directly, and like this. So this assumption or this inherent simplicity of this form can be very deceiving. Where you have a non isothermal surface, things become complicated very quickly, because you have multiple channels, multiple paths for heat transfer, whereas here you have only one path. From 1 to 2 you do not care, okay. And again here axial conduction will be there, that we are neglecting, that is okay, okay. So this is one, and there are formulae available, catalogs are there, view factor algebra catalogs are there for various geometries for getting the view factors, and I think many textbooks carry bulk of these things. On the net also you have Howell's catalog etcetera, which are available. Parallel disks, parallel rectangles, perpendicular surfaces with a common edge, parallel plates with different dimensions, inclined plates with a common edge, so on and so forth, okay. So all these people have done and come up with these expressions which are presented, and all we need to do is use them correctly, that is all. And these are also presented in the form of graphs. I think nowadays nobody uses these graphs anymore, because we can do the algebra also quite easily. So I am not going to spend time on this, okay. So this is again redundant, small problem associated with view factor calculation, this is also not needed. Yeah, symmetry rule, this is again obvious. One, if the geometry can be made into a symmetrical geometry, then what is going from 1 to 2 should not matter whether it is the surface 2 or 3, it should be identical. So that is one thing, and associated with a tetrahedron, okay. So this is a problem, 1, 2, 5 plus 4 plus 2 plus 3, all of them add to 1. So if you know what is the view factor from 1 to 2, everything else will be identical, 4 times that.
So 1 1 is 0, and all are equal, so they turn out to be 1 by 4.
Okay, so these are just exercises which are quite simple.
We'll just state it and leave it.
Okay, so cross ring method is one of the methods which is used, was used actually, even now it is used to get the view factors for infinitely long surface. Now what is this infinitely long surface? Why is this infinite long surface assumption? What if it is not infinite? End effects are neglected because of this. So whatever radiation is there, and believe me actually if you have finite length geometry, many times this infinite length assumption if you use, you do not get correct results actually, you do not get. So blindly people use infinite length geometry formulae for finite length geometries, things can be off as much as 100%, okay. Yeah, I have two short cylinders of this dimension, I cannot use infinite length formula for that, it is not correct, okay. So that is something, again this is just buried under. We use, because it is available formula, we will use Bernoulli equation, we will use Kirchhoff's law, epsilon equal to alpha, we will use whether the conditions are satisfied or no, okay. So such geometries, especially infinite length geometries, we can be considering them as two dimensional. So end effects are neglected and view factor is done by this so called cross strings method. What it tells me is F1 to 2 is nothing but the lengths of the cross strings minus lengths of the uncrossed strings, which is this, divided by 2 times string on surface I, that is the source surface. So this is 2 times L1, okay. So with these, cross string method is generally applicable when two surfaces consider even share a common edge such as a triangle, common edge can be treated as an imaginary string of length 0. Okay. So, it is quite a powerful thing, but again you have to be careful. So, okay. So, now fun part is over. Now, we will come to business. So, okay, having studied U factors, what are we going to use it for? We have to study heat transfer interaction. So, if heat is all the while before it was one surface, now two surfaces are there. So, let us try to see what is going to be the interaction between the two surfaces. Just because surface 1 is giving out energy, surface 2 is not going to sit idle, it is also going to give out energy and part of it is going to be seen by this. So, if this surface for example is at say 1000 Kelvin and that is at 400 Kelvin, over time what is going to happen? This is going to lose heat, that is going to gain heat. This I think logically we can tell. So, that means there is a net loss of energy from this surface which manifests itself by a decrease in temperature, net gain of energy of that surface which is manifesting by a rise in temperature. So, what I have to say is E in minus E out is equal to, we have never used that equation here, but inherently that is there all the time, it is undercurrent. E in minus E out, E generated 0 is equal to dE by dt, which is manifesting itself as a change in temperature with respect to time. Once things have reached steady state, you will not have any heat transfer exchange between them. Okay. So, this dE by dt is also there and it is there because of the temperature difference, and what happens is this goes down from 1000 to whatever 900, 800, so on and so forth, that energy content changes. And so, E in E out also will be changing in radiation because of the change in temperature. So, essentially what we are going to do is,
we are taking always in the radiation only the steady state condition.
Yes.
We are not considering unsteady radiation at all anywhere. Okay. So, all through we are going to take only the steady state radiation.
What is the heat transfer between surface T1 and T2 when they are at this given temperatures? After that next instant of time T1 has gone down and T2 has gone up, we are not concerned with that. With these given values of temperature or at this instant, what is this?
Somehow I am managing them that they are continuously being monitored.
But such that the temperatures are anchored at T1 and T2. Okay. So, that is a inherent thing. We are fixing the temperatures and trying to solve. In real life, it will be a different ball game actually.
For example, if you put things in furnace, when you just load the material inside the furnace, definitely my wall temperatures are come down
because of my loading. I am loading, no? So, again it will take a while, or otherwise I have to increase the heat flux to overcome this loading because of putting the boulder or whatever I have put inside. So, steady state does not come just like that, but here in all our analysis throughout we are taking steady state.
Okay. So, Q1 to 2, what does this tell me? This is just giving me the net energy transfer from 1 to 2. That means, at steady state, Q1 represents the amount of energy which is leaving 1. Something is coming on to 2, the difference, something is coming into 1, the difference between these two, what is leaving minus what is coming in because of surface 2. Here we are going to consider only two surfaces, and what is the nature of the surfaces? We will deal black body first, because black body is easy. So, two black bodies are there, those two black bodies are at finite temperature T1 and T2, they have areas A1 and A2. So, what is the net energy transfer? Logic tells me if T1 is greater than T2, Q1 to 2 is greater than 0, correct? Higher temperature body, there will be a net energy loss, energy transfer from 1 to 2, correct? If I write Q2 to 1, 2 to 1 will be receiving energy from 1. Okay. So, the signs will be opposite, that is all. Okay. So, what I am saying is, now let us use reciprocity, A1 F12 is A2 F21, this will be useful little later. So Q 1 to 2 inwards E in minus E out. Instead of E in minus E out, I am writing radiation leaving the entire surface 1 that strikes 2. I do not care about other things. 1 and 2, there is open space here, open space here. I am not concerned with that. I am dealing with what is between 1 and 2 alone, what is between 2 and 1 alone. So, what fraction of energy leaving 1 reaches 2 minus what fraction of energy emitted by 2 or energy leaving, I should not use emitted, what fraction of radiation leaving 2 strike surface 1. Why should I not use emitted word? I corrected myself. Radiosity is what we have to deal with, not just emission, because emission happens by virtue of temperature. But reflection can happen because of other components of energy coming onto the surface. What is coming from a surface 3 here will also get part of it will get reflected in this direction to surface 2. Okay, so, radiation leaving. So, Q 1 to 2 therefore is what? Let us look at one term, the other term is identical. Eb 1 is the emissive power, watt per meter square. Heat flux associated with that surface 1, which is at temperature T 1 times A 1 will give me total heat transfer rate, watt. That is what is coming out of the surface. How much of that reaches surface 2 is multiplied, obtained by multiplying this number with F 1 to 2. This is what is going from here to here. What is coming from there to here? Is A 2 E B 2, again the same logic, times F 2 to 1. And now I use reciprocity theorem, which is here. This I know I would like to deal with surface 1. So, I will use A 2 F 2 1 is A 1 F 1 2. So, I pull that out common. So, Q 1 to 2 is A 1 F 1 2 E B 1 minus E B 2. And we know Eb is nothing but sigma t to the power 4, that sigma also comes out. That is how you get this famous equation T 1 raised to 4 minus T 2 raised to 4 times sigma epsilon 1 A 1, because it is black body. If it is not a black body, what will happen? Emissive powers will be associated here. We will see that as the next steps. So, Q dot 1 is nothing but Q 1 to 2, which is same as minus Q dot 2, just bringing this to perspective. If I have n black surfaces, same thing can be extrapolated, Y 2 can have multiple black surfaces. So, it is just the summation. So, the net energy transfer, the net energy, net radiation heat transfer from surface 1 is nothing but summation of this. J goes from 1 to n, n could be 2, 3, 4, etcetera, etcetera. Negative value of heat transfer indicates that net radiation heat transfer from surface I, that is surface I gains energy instead of losing. Also, net transfer from a surface to itself is 0 regardless of the shape of the surface. From a surface to itself is 0, this word should be is. Okay. So, Q I for 1 to 3 surfaces is nothing but something given like this. Put that for that, then we will go through that. Okay. So, what is governing this heat transfer rate from one to the other? There was some concept L by K for plane wall. 1 by HA for what if there is no temperature difference, there is no heat transfer. So, that we have to keep in mind. So, temperature difference is there, something is going to prevent heat transfer or is going to change the heat transfer even though there is the same temperature difference. That is what we called as thermal resistance. We change the resistance, we get higher heat transfer for the same temperature difference, so on and so forth. Now, we are saying, okay, in radiation also, just because there is a temperature difference, yes, we appreciate that. I have 1000 degrees Kelvin, 400 Kelvin, two surfaces, I bring them closer, I can see it much heat transfer. If I take it away, lesser heat transfer between the two. So, temperatures are the same. So, driving delta T is the same, but between these two cases there is a difference in heat transfer. So, something has to govern the heat flow, and so there is some so called resistance which is there, analogous or similar in concept, conceptually at least I can relate, saying that just as we had a conduction convection resistance, there must be something which is going to drive the amount of energy flow for similar temperature differences, and that we will call as space resistance, geometry resistance, we will see that. So, this Q1 is summation of Q1 to 1 plus Q1 to 2 plus Q1 to 3. Q1 to 1 0 because it is a plane wall. Q1 to 2 is A1 F1 to 2 sigma T1 raised to 4 minus T2 raised to 4, just like expanding this into 3 terms. And the third term is for F1 to 3. What can you say by inspection for F1 to 2 and 1 to 3? If this is an equilateral triangle, what is F1 to 2 and F1 to 3? Same. What is the value? 0.5. Okay. Because symmetrical, 1 is 0.
F1 is 0. So,
other two are same. So, it should be half. So, this essentially will boil down to sigma T1 raised to 4 minus T2 raised to 4. As I told you before, I like to keep everything in the denominator except some temperature difference. Here, instead of temperature difference, this sigma T to the power 4, that is kept in the numerator. Why? Because the sigma T to the power 4 is your, what is sigma T to the power 4? Emissive power of the black body at that temperature. So, we are dealing not with temperatures, we are dealing with the emissive powers associated with that temperature. So, sigma T to the power 4 is like your T. Sigma T2 to the power 4 is like your another T. The difference between them, that is the driving potential for heat transfer divided by some kind of resistance to heat transfer. Okay. T physically I can bring sigma down, does not matter, but it does not make sense to bring sigma down because T1 I cannot give a physical interpretation to it. Sigma T1 to the power 4 I can relate it to Eb1, sigma T2 to the power 4 is Eb2, that is why that sigma is stuck there, because I had told delta T divided by everything else. One, I have to take that back, physically driving potential to resistance. Okay. So, when I write it in that form, I will get this as in this way, and for Q2, which is from 2 to 2, 2 to 1, 2 to 3, I can write it in similar form, similarly for 3. And this quantity is dependent on view factor. What is coming in the denominator? These two terms, these two terms, these two terms, depends on the area of the surface also and the view factor.
View, it is
physically
also we can
relate.
Can we not see that? The more they are seeing each other, if they are just like this, will the interaction will be more? No.
If they are seeing each other, then my view factor is.
So it is only representative. So the word space resistance, professor used. It's really, you can feel that.
Space resistance we can feel actually.
Space resistance you can.
I bring it closer. View factor has increased. Resistance to heat transfer would have decreased. Therefore. The net heat transfer between them will be more. You can change for example, 1 to 3, if it was 0.5 versus 0.4, this denominator will appropriately change and you will have a different heat transfer rate. Okay. Shape factor, configuration factor, view factor, all are the same. Shape resistance.
Okay. How is the difference? Actually, as far as I understand, all are same. In fact, if I am correct, every name I have put there, I think.
It is a geometrical factor which depends on the shape. That is shape factor.
I think this nitpicking happens when we use.
No, as far as our analysis is concerned, shape factor, configuration factor, angle factor, all are same. PK Nag would have specified what he means when he is using with something else.
But might
as
say
far as
this is used for these kind of situations or something, I don't know.
Yeah. Okay, we will see that. But as far as this analysis is concerned, this is what it is. In fact, if you see any UG book, this is what we will see.
Yeah.
Coming close,
U factor will increase. Geometry distance decreases. Decreases.
Sir, right. I could not see that. I was wondering.
When he was telling, I could not see that actually. I was wondering why should view factor increase or decrease when they are coming closer. After professor told that R squared is sitting na in my view factor. So that is how coming close, and so that is why space resistance.
Yeah, I keep my hand here. I feel the heat more.
Yeah.
I take it away, I feel heat less.
Nearer the fire, it's always dangerous.
About this, sir, between the two surfaces.
Yes.
We are not taking the distance, in fact, we are taking
view factor is having distance. What is the definition of a view factor? What is the definition of view factor? Cos theta 1, cos theta 2,
cos theta 1, cos theta 2, double integral divided by
R squared.
R is what?
Ah.
You also had the same question. When in doubt, think of examples like this. You keep your hand on the gas when it is burning. Is it possible to keep? No, na? You take it up, you can keep. Why? Just radiation, heat, view factor. The same fire, same hand. You don't feel the heat that much. Okay.